hereby call this conference to order. We start some music. We have John Sigerson and Margaret Greenspan, and they will sing Beethoven's Adelaida.
Thank you.
say that my very, very good friend indeed, Helga Zepp LaRouche, would make a speech at one and the same time to announce a plan of excellence. I have always found her to be gifted with effective leadership. I've always admired the creativity of her ideas and the clarity of her exposition. I've always admired, too, the tenacity in which she pursues and exploits breakthroughs. I shan't be long, I will merely remind you that she has the three graces. She has the vision, which we call prevision, to see what is necessary beforehand. And the second P, pre-planning, what to do about it. And thirdly, P, provision of resources to deal with any emergency in our culture, in our civilization that may ensue. So it gives me great pleasure indeed to introduce and announce for you our keynote speaker, the founder of the Schiller Institute, Helga Zepp LaRouche.
Change the United United States, Europe, and Japan, while these places will soon die of AIDS because the medical supplies will not be there, the food will not be there, and you know, this will all be doomed. Then you see beautiful countries like Colombia. What is happening there? The dope mafia, for economic reasons, is challenging the power and sovereignty of the government and has declared total war against the political class. They want to kill every politician if they do not submit to the rules of the dope mafia. And then, you know what this means. The courageous mayoral candidate of Bogota, Pastrana, who was kidnapped and fortunately could be freed, he pointed to the fact that all these talks why the dope traffic would be advantageous for Colombia is a lie, because the dope addiction of the population in Colombia is increasing tremendously, and therefore it's killing the very people for whom it's supposedly to be good. But also, you would look at the industrialized countries, at America, big, rich America, which, you know, was supposed to be the leader of the free West, and what would you see? Approximately 40 million people, that is like a normal sized country, are going hungry in this country every day. You know what that means? It means that half of the United States, or well, you know, at least a quarter of the United States, is like a developing country. It's the only difference that for any noble soul, it is so much more horrible to see the decay of somebody who already was advanced collapse than somebody who not even reached that development. It is much more painful to see the decay of something which was not necessary. And 50% of this country are poor, and the gap is widening. The filthily rich, jet-set oligarchs, they don't care, they become richer, and they want to keep their fancy lifestyle, even if their fellow Americans, you know, are plunging into slums, ghettos. And you go into every American city and you find slums like the Bronx, like, you know, the most bombed out areas of New York. In Europe, it's very similar. Europe is maybe partially not quite as decayed yet, but you know, you have areas which are on the same boat. Just look at Great Britain, what they have done to their own people. I only wanted to mention the East Bloc, Romania, Bulgaria. Well, the great government of Romania has just put in a law in the winter, which only permits its citizens light bulbs of 40 watts and heating to be 52 degrees Fahrenheit. So the great message of socialism is, or whatever you call the system, freezing in the dark. So I just want to leave it at that, to highlight these points to say that right now, in the year 1988, the majority of human beings are not living a dignified life. The majority of mankind de facto is in slavery right now, not worse than the slaves, you know, before they so-called were liberated, because of the absolutely oppressive material conditions. Okay, so this is the first vision I want you to have. Then the second, you look at something different. Again, with the eyes of the visitor from the past, or maybe the happy survivor of the next century. What do you see? You see sciences which are incredible. All the technological and scientific conditions would be there to eliminate power and hunger forever. You have fission, you have laser technology, you have modern materials, you have superconducting, you have all kinds of things which, if they would be applied on a large scale, they would eliminate poverty on this earth in very few months and maybe years. Then you see, is there a lack of ideas what to do? What Lynn was talking about yesterday, this is not new. I mean, sure, it's better put together, but these are all concepts which exist since decades. The idea for African development was well worked out in the 40s, in the 30s. People in Europe had in their desks all the plans what to do, to build railroads, to build irrigation, to build bridges, ports, agricultural development for Africa. It was all thought out already in the 30s. Well, the same obviously for the Middle East. The idea of Latin American integration, there are many bright, intelligent people in this continent who know what to do, would know what to do. As a matter of fact, they were already on the road to build big projects like in Egypt, in Brazil, when the IMF and the World Bank came in and forbid it. So also the infrastructure program of MITI, the Mitsubishi Institute, we know all the big projects which could be done. And we have, you know, plans like the encyclical of Pope Paul VI, Populorum Progressio, which was demanding 21 years ago the urgent need to have a new just world economic order. So why are these things not used? If the technology is there, if the designs are there, what is then the problem? So I want you to look at a third problem. The leading financial circles are in abysmal moral decay. The jet set, the oligarchical landowners of the type of Tone Taxes, this despicable creature who, you know, whose wife, whatever you call this thing, but you know, she now has bought herself a bra of $400,000 made of diamonds. This gives you, you know, this is what these people are. The high oligarchy of Europe happens to infest the most beautiful places in the developing country as well. Like these people have bought a lot of land because they believe in the value of the land and their power of the land. They are the dope runners. We know that the entire European side of Iran Gate are the top Masonic lodges who are controlling the dope traffic. And we have said since a long time that gun running and dope running are one and the same thing. And their lifestyle, obviously, is characterized by total selfishness, and they couldn't care less if Africa dies as a continent as a whole. So these people are the reason why we are in this problem, and one has to face that. It's not a natural catastrophe. It's not a sociological phenomena, but it is very clear-cut people, living persons, who are behind this problem. They are the ones who have invented the lie of environmentalism because, you know, they don't like to have these many masses around them, and they don't want tourism around them. They hate overpopulation because it may intrude on their lifestyles. You know, they would like to have Kenya depopulated, just have one big casino there and maybe three slaves for their services. They are neo-Malthusians. They are basically believers in the theory that people should be eliminated and the present amount of people, the present number of people should go down. This, by the way, is the same in East and West. One person who eventually will be brought in front of the court of justice, a liberal professor from the United States called Vidal Gore, had the audacity to make a speech in Sao Paulo, or in Rio de Janeiro, I think it was, about 4 months ago, where he said that AIDS was a good thing because it eventually would reduce the world population to 1 billion people. Well, and the Soviet equivalent was the so-called health minister of the Soviet Union, who just made a speech in London saying that the Russian race is genetically superior and therefore will not be affected by AIDS as much. So it is very clear that if this world outlook prevails, mankind is doomed. Because, well, you know, this is something what we call the subjective problem. It is very clear that AIDS right now is the only objective problem for which we have not yet found a solution. And all the other problems, as I have pointed, the development programs exist, the technologies exist, is an entirely subjective question. And obviously, the key problem of why this is what image of man do people have today? Morally, I think it is very clear that we are in a dark age. We are like in the end phase of the Roman Empire, when the Caesars and the elites were sitting and banqueting up to the point where they could not eat so much anymore that they had to take a feather of a peasant, tickle their throat, you know, do the, what nowadays is called bulimia, and then start all over again. And have all the same, they had all the same kinds of sexual perversions you can see today. And as it was the case with the Roman Empire, because of the general degeneracy of the elites, they could not recognize anymore what dangers from the outside and the inside would threaten their system, and therefore they went under. And I would say this is the same thing today. President Reagan making this spectacle with Gorbachev means these elites in this country do not recognize anymore the threat from the outside, and they do not recognize the threat from the inside in the form of AIDS. If we do not change this, we will plunge into a period like the 14th century and worse. And you see the signs. We live in witchcraft and you know all kinds of survival of the fittest ideas, Satanism. And unfortunately, the ruling elites, and you can tell it by the TV programs they produce, they have an image of man which is that of a beast. If you do not believe me, watch Dynasty once and you will immediately be convinced, because the morality is how to stab your neighbor in the back in the most efficient way. The philosophical basis of what is happening in economics today is nothing but Calvinism. These people have no morality except not to be caught. The only sin for them is that you get somehow caught, then you are an outcast and you be sacrificed, like the minister president of Schleswig-Holstein, Barschel, who was murdered, or Jelly from P2. In these circles, you cannot be caught. This is against the ethics, and that's the only thing which is against it. But just think, if the power elites today accept a society when the image of man is that they commit that our children are dope addicts, that their minds are destroyed, and the disappearing children in the world is by now, I would say, on a monthly basis, 50,000 or so. In the United States, 400,000 children a year for sex ring, pornographic rings, and so forth. And what does it say about mankind when everybody knows that 2 to 3 billion people in the world are hungry every day, and people just say, well, I don't care. What does it say about people? Well, we have a different approach. We say, as the great poet Friedrich Schiller, after whom the Schiller Institute is called, that we have just to give people enough to eat, and their dignity will come by itself. If mankind is to survive, it will be only on the basis of a just new world economic order. And I would like to discuss a little bit of what justice actually is. Today, it's that despotism of power elites which rules the world. And what we have to do is to turn this around and reestablish a world order which is based on natural law and an image of man which is associated with natural law. And that means that each living human being on this planet has inalienable rights which basically come because each human being has this dignity, because each human being has a divine potential for the creative development of his mind. Man is the only being in the physical universe which is capable of changing the modes of its existence. No animal is capable of doing that, as lovable as they may be. Some of them. In Christianity, this idea of man is called that man participates in the divine. When he continues the process of creation in the image of God, the Creator. In other words, when he replicates on earth the most noble aspect of God, his creative abilities, then he is in the image of God. So even so, this is a thought which comes from Christianity. I think it is very clearly an ecumenical concept which easily can be accepted by any other religions and philosophies who are in that basic world outlook, like Hinduism and others who equally value the sacredness of each human being. The dignity of man, so defined, derives from the freedom, from the capacity of man for freedom and reason. And to recognize this dignity means to place the value of man above all things which can be created by man. That means each individual human being is more valuable than all the money in the world, than all the goods in the world, than anything which man has created, and that includes paper, money, and so forth. If the life of each human being is sacred in this way, it is very clear that the economy is nothing but the material basis for the existence of mankind, and not a value in itself. The production of tangible goods is only there for the survival of mankind and not to maintain a bankrupt banking system or the extravagancy of the few. Furthermore, it is clear that if you define the economy as the servant of man, then it must go negentropically. Why? Because the population density on each level of technology used in production is finite, and so are the related resources used. The hunting and gathering society was able to maintain about 5 to 10 million people on the entire earth. Then when agriculture was invented about 8000 BC, this represented a major revolution and increased the potential population density by many orders of magnitude. And the quality, the production of agricultural production, therefore, has up to the present day and always will have extremely important significance, and therefore has dignity, and so do all people who are working in the area of agriculture, because it is their very work which helps to feed the population. So when science and technology progressed, there was always associated with each technological step of progress a higher energy density in production, resulting into a higher potential population density. So where did this progress come from? I agree with the great philosopher of the 15th century, Nicolaus von Kuhs, who said that the place where progress occurs is the human soul. So much so that all the sciences would not exist but for the creative activity of the soul. So, therefore, because the soul is able to make concepts which affect the physical universe in the sense of generating progress, this means that what the mind and the soul of the human being are thinking is effective in the physical universe. And therefore, the laws of the mind and the laws of the physical universe and the relations among countries, the overwhelming majority of the world population today lives in poverty and hunger. And this, because it violates the laws of the universe, will mean that the entire human population will go under if we do not change. So the reason why we called a new Bretton Woods conference in order to start a new age is precisely because that we are not only talking about financial systems, we are talking about how to restore a political, financial life and action in the world which is in cohesion with the underlying laws of the universe. The Bretton Woods system was unjust from the beginning. The parities for the developing countries were put on such a low level that from the beginning they had to sell cheap whatever they produced and they had to buy expensive. This lasted now for over 40 years and it became much, much more brutal in the middle of the 70s when the IMF conditionalities started to put these countries at an ever higher disadvantage. You take Mexico and the devaluation of the peso, which is now astronomical, and you can see that this is becoming quite ridiculous. So the high interest rate policy and the devaluations and general IMF conditionalities have created a situation where now it is an objective fact that none of the third world debt can be paid nor should be paid. Because, frankly, I think that the whole question of justice must be brought in these discussions. And if you think that not only have these countries been thrown into poverty, death, but they have also been since 44, if you want to start at any given point, of development. And I think that if we go for a new just world economic order, they will have to be compensated for the lost potentialities, not only the debt, but also the lost potentialities. And the minimum, the absolute moral minimum we can do, you know, who after all profited from all of this, is that we immediately establish these margin plans. It's the moral thing to do, and it is in our self-interest because expanding markets are obviously what will bring out our economies out of the mess. And this, as you know, will not be inflationary at all because if credits are given for real production, then there is no problem. And the source of wealth, after all, is not the possession of land or raw materials, but the increase of productivity in labor. And therefore, anything we do to increase the productivity of the developing sector will pay for itself. We say we need a just new world economic order. And what does just mean? Justice is one of the key principles of life. The relationship, it defines the relationship among individuals, among societies, and among peoples. The very meaning of human life is connected to the idea of justice. The question how much we all together owe to each human individual is a question one can ask. For example, how much do we as mankind or all individuals together owe to each child in Africa, Asia, or Latin America? We owe to make possible the development of all potentialities of this child, each child. That's what we owe. Forget about money. Money is absolutely unimportant. Wealth is unimportant. We owe these children that they can develop their divine potential. And what does each individual owe to society? Well, each individual has the obligation to develop the potentialities he or she is capable so that he or she can contribute to the maximum to the development of society as a whole. This is the definition of owing or debt, which, by the way, comes from the Latin debitum. And I think we must have a redefinition of what that actually means and not accept the terminology of the bankers. To determine what is justice in this sense is one of the great tasks of mankind. And to make the relationship between all human beings on this earth just is one of the questions we have to struggle for a long, long time to come. And it gives meaning to our lives. It is one of the fundamental human rights based on natural law for a person to be able to live in a just world. And it is his duty to act towards his neighbors as well as people very distant from him. Justice means to give each person what he requires, the fruit of his work, but also respect and recognition. Even so, I don't like the United Nations much for all the known reasons. But after all, they have declared a charter of human rights. And, well, I want to tell you what they are, and then you compare the reality in this world. The United Nations Human Rights Charter says that all human beings on this earth must have the right to life, freedom, security of the person, nourishment, clothing, housing, health, recreation and free time, expression of thought, conscience and religion, to practice religion, to build a family, to have the material preconditions to maintain a family, to have private property, work, and adequate wage, the right to reunion, organization, to travel freely, to have citizenship and a place of living, to participate in free elections, the right for education, and so forth and so on. You just take these basic human rights, and then you look who in the world today has these rights. You must come to the conclusion that the absolute majority of all people do not participate in these basic human rights. Therefore, a new just world economic order must create the conditions where these rights will be guaranteed for all people. The American Declaration of Independence and the American Constitution was drawn up by the Founding Fathers to express precisely these noble ideas. And they had at that time a very clear idea of what the mission of America was supposed to be, namely to organize all over the world, to bring about a community of principles where these rights would be there for all people. Compare this to how foreign policy is being conducted by the State Department today. This idea that mankind has the mission to accomplish justice for all people is a very old idea, and it is what we value as the values of the West, that which makes us proud, or used to make us proud, why we are different than totalitarianism in the Soviet Union. It's an idea which was pronounced once very excellently by Nicolaus of Cusa, who said that national sovereignty is the only precondition how the freedom of the individual can be guaranteed, and why the representative republican system is the only way how this can be maintained. Nicolaus von Cusa also said that only if you have the maximum development of all microcosms, i.e. all individual people, individuals, nations, only then you can have concordancia, peace in the macrocosm, the world at large. The idea of the encyclica Populorum Progressio about the development of all people has the very same idea. Leibniz was one person who said the way to accomplish that is, this was in the 17th century, that we give each European nation one part of the world to develop, and in a short period of time we will have overcome these imbalances think what Schiller was asking in the aesthetical letters is as much true for us as it was for him then. Because when the French Revolution started to chop off the heads of the scientists and terror took over, he said, what do we do if the ruling class is decadent, if the elites are the problem and have caused the problem, and when the masses are weak and confused? Well, this is the problem we have today, because if you basically accept the idea that man is not born for the present condition, but that we have a higher purpose, well, you have to accept the idea that the moral transformation of mankind is the reason why we live. So to bring people, all people, on the level of reason is what we have to succeed in. This means nothing else than the freeing of the divine potential in all individuals and to strengthen the power for self-reflection of all. Schiller calls this to take divinity in our will. So Schiller's notion of man is what we are fighting for. That's what the Schiller Institute is all about. The image of man, therefore, we think must be the basis for a new just world economic order, is Schiller's idea of a beautiful soul. A beautiful soul is a person who is free, but acts according to necessity, and does what is necessary, not like a bureaucrat, not like a Kantian slave, but with passion, with joy. And it is a genius, because only the genius can expand lawfulness in a lawful way and create new rules in cohesion with the laws. And such a person will be a happy person, it will be a joyful person and a beautiful person. So Schiller was not only the poet of freedom by putting such notions into circulation, I think he is the poet of agape, of love in the true sense, because all his entire works, his dramas, his poems, his writings, aesthetical and historical writings, had only one aim, reflecting his compassionate effort to reach into the souls and hearts of people in order to unleash that power of love in reason in them. And I think never so far a more beautiful ideal of man has been defined. A man, an image of man who is capable and acts on the level of reason, love, freedom, and indefinite development. Schiller, during the time of the American Revolution, thought that the American Revolution would signify the beginning of the age of reason. As you know, this did not happen. Mankind had many setbacks and plunged into moral crises, the worst of which we are in right now. But I believe that if Schiller would be alive today, and I think he is, because you know he's accompanying me all the time, so he's very much real. He would look at this world and he would say, the fact that technologies today exist, which did not exist 200 years ago, means that for the very first time, we have the material preconditions for the age of reason and the dignity of man, because if people can eat, live, house, raise families and so forth, then dignity has a chance to develop. So therefore, you know, it's all our problem. We have to be warriors of angels, warrior angels for the good. Schiller, after thinking how do you do this when the government is the problem, the institutions have brought the mess about and the masses are too weak or confused, well, how do you solve this? He says, reason will select the most powerful fighters and will arm these human beings with divine weapons, and so forth through the victory of reason in the end. He says, be picture or something like that, what would my fellow companions do? They would rip me apart. So, you know, people then have to fight and have to decide what is more worse. Is it the temporary agony to be courageous, stand up? Is this what should determine what you make out of your life? Or is it the vision of what mankind can be, which you should act upon? So be courageous, that's what Schiller says. If you have the courage to be a warrior angel, actually you will recognize that there are riches you have not dreamt to exist before. So Schiller says, it is not without reason that the myth, the mythology, had the goddess of wisdom, Athena, jump out of the head of Jupiter in full armament, because her first act was to fight. You have to fight stupidity, prejudices, and all these things around you. We have to do it, because what Schiller said then, that the masses were too confused, is so much more true today, because if you are starving, you have no energy to even take care of yourself. So it can only come from us. So we have to be warrior angels and we have to have courage. Because what is at stake is mankind worthy of itself. Because there must be something burning in your heart where you cannot tolerate to see mankind in this awful condition. And this must be more important to you than anything you think is important now. Because you have to take the point of view Schiller had when he wrote The Universal History, where he makes a beautiful review and says, mankind has progressed up to the present point through the struggle of generations and generations who were suffering to get mankind to this point. Many people had to pay with their lives to get the improvement in the course of universal history. And whoever of you who has a noble heart and a beautiful soul, who would not have a compassionate desire to contribute to your actions so that future generations will be the ones who will have the fruits of what we are doing today? And I can see very clearly, if we win this fight, I can very easily see that 2-3 generations from now, we will have totally eradicated hunger, poverty, and the misery we see today. I can envision that Africa, for example, will be a blooming garden because, you know, the fertile conditions of the ground is there. We can turn the Sahara into flowering fields where people will build cities, they build architecture, they do things which are typical for Renaissance people to do. They build beautiful cathedrals, theaters. They will have a fulfilled life. We will have missions into space. People will stop to be bested. I believe that mankind can reach that condition. Because I do not believe that man is born, that man has been created to be a beast. I believe that there is a time where we can realize a human world. And I think we are now at the punctum saliens in history, where our action will make a difference. But I want to impress you that maybe your children or your grandchildren will be the spectators looking back at what we do today and then will be proud of you because you helped to make it happen.
Chuck's from Illinois. He's a Roman Catholic priest, parish priest, and he sends it to the Schiller Institute. He says very shortly, on behalf of efforts for development of the third world, I wish you success for your work, and I wish you God's help and God's blessings. I also have a message from Mr. MacDonald, who's a state representative of Minnesota. I send my greetings as a fellow supporter of the movement to defend our Judeo-Christian values in the West against those who wish to depopulate the world through disease, famine, or permit us to fall prey to the sovereigns by weakening our commitment to these values. As a member of the Agricultural Committee of Minnesota, of the Minnesota State House of Representatives, I'm aware of the potential of our farmers to feed the entire world. I endorse the effort to do so, as represented by the commitment of the people at this conference, so that indeed we may have a new, just, more humane economic order. And National Right to Life organization in Minneapolis, Minnesota. It's always been to me one of the ironies of modern civilization that we have to form a right to life society. It's ironic, isn't it? But then, if you know how beast yourself, you're saying, those people over there are you. It is those of us who believe in life who have to defend it. Now, this lady says, the Schiller Institute, for several decades, I have waged a war to stop the genocidal policies of abortion, forced sterilization, and euthanasia that's being imposed against the third world populations abroad, and particularly populations in America. I have long documented the fact that these policies of so-called family planning were really plans for family extinction by those who are determined by the establishment elite to be useless eaters. This deliberate and cold-blooded murder plan can best be confirmed in the alarming policy document known as Global 2000, which calls for the reduction of the world's population of brown, black, and yellow peoples by one half by the year 2000. As this planned extermination of over half of civilization has gained momentum over the ensuing years of economic racism, she says, occupied by the shutdown of US farms, US manufacturing, US industry, the medical profession, and a commitment to advancing the development of moral, traditional family values, and belief in the right to life, as far as all this has gained momentum, I fear that without a new grander initiative to undo these evils, now destroying a belief in the primacy of life, humanity will become an extinct species. We need to establish a new order of justice, the lady says, for the besieged populations of the world. We need to give our children hope, the value of life. For this, the Schiller Institute has my commitment, my determination to fight side by side with you. My prayers are with you in all your current deliberations. I'm a craven, Minister. And at this stage, this is from Mr. Ronald Thelen, the National Vice President for the Cement Masons AFL-CIO. For the United States and Canada, the Schiller Institute. Today, our labor force is idle and out of work. It's living in streets, homeless, standing in food kitchen lines, simply lost. We are out of work, not for lack of desire to work, but for the deliberate shutdown of vision by the Eastern establishment. And fail to understand that as labor goes, so goes the nation, so goes the world. our cities are being destroyed from the shutdown of America's productive labor force. It is becoming a dirty word to even say the word production, because the powers that be are pushing service economies. The skilled level of our potential labor force has dropped to an all-time low. Unless we return to the principles of our founding fathers, understanding the importance of labor, people such as Alexander Hamilton, Henry Carey, who knew that the real wealth of any nation is the productive capabilities of the individual citizens to do the good. Unless we return to that stage, we shall find ourselves in a forced exporting economy and becoming a forced exporting colony with no ability to determine our fate for the good of the nation and for the good of the world. We must win this war for economic justice, sincere years from the head.
Que la edificación de estas economías avanzadas y desarrolladas
ha sido posible en base a la transferencia de valores que han hecho las regiones subdesarrolladas a esos centros industriales, desde la época de la colonización hasta nuestros días. Así que no es accidental que nuestros países en el presente se encuentren sumidos en la miseria, sino que responde de hecho a razones históricas desde la época de la colonia. La República Dominicana, país que yo represento en este evento, pertenece a este segundo grupo de países, denominados por algunos tratadistas como subdesarrollados, como países periféricos, como países tercermundistas o países en vías de desarrollo. Fruto de la división internacional del trabajo, a nuestra economía le ha competido y correspondido, al igual que a otras naciones latinoamericanas y del mundo, erigir un modelo de desarrollo agroexportador, basado en la venta al mercado internacional de productos agrícolas con escaso valor agregado, de productos agrícolas que ven hoy en día reducidos sus precios en los mercados internacionales. Tal es el caso del azúcar, el café, el cacao, el tabaco, que son los principales productos de exportación sobre los que se dirige realmente la economía dominicana. Estos productos están sujetos a muchas inestabilidades de mercado y más aún a inestabilidades de precio en esos mercados internacionales. O lo que es peor aún, en el caso del azúcar, el principal producto de exportación de nuestra economía, ha sido reducida de una manera significativa la cuota azucarera por el mercado norteamericano. Mientras tanto, los bienes y productos industrializados que importan nuestras economías, como el petróleo, como los bienes procesados, los bienes de capital, incrementan sus precios, generando de por sí entonces un marcado deterioro en los términos de intercambio de nuestras economías. Este deterioro en los términos de intercambio constituye el principal elemento de la balanza comercial. Hasta finales de la década de los 70, la caída de los precios internacionales de nuestros principales productos de exportación constituía el fundamento de las crisis coyunturales que sufría nuestra economía. Hoy en día, sin embargo, las características de esa crisis son diferentes, ya que se han adicionado otros factores. En primer lugar, las distorsiones generadas en la economía por el mal llamado proceso de sustitución de importaciones, que por una parte favoreció en forma desproporcional la formación de capital fijo en el sector industrial en detrimento de otros sectores productivos. Por otro lado, creó una alta capacidad ociosa en las instalaciones de industrias con capacidad superior a la que el mercado de nuestras economías demandaba. Generó también una mayor demanda de importaciones, ya no de bienes de consumo, sino de materias primas para la industria, lo que pone a depender de nuestras estructuras productivas del mercado internacional, haciendo en lo adelante que el déficit de esta balanza comercial adquiera condiciones ya no coyunturales, sino de crisis estructural, porque ya no dependemos solamente de las importaciones de bienes de consumo directo, sino fundamentalmente que el desarrollo de la actividad productiva nuestra, a través de las importaciones de insumos para la industria y de bienes de capital, hace de hecho ya una mayor dependencia de nuestra actividad productiva de ese mercado internacional. En adición a esto, las políticas proteccionistas de los Estados Unidos y de la Comunidad Económica Europea, que son los principales mercados de nuestros productos de exportación, han generado una caída drástica del consumo de estos productos tradicionales nuestros y un desplazamiento hacia otros sustitutos que son producidos en las economías centrales. Esta caída de las exportaciones y el crecimiento acelerado de nuestras importaciones debilita la posibilidad de acumulación futura de capital, ya que nuestras compras en el exterior de insumos para la producción tienen que financiarse en base al endeudamiento externo. De ahí, el mercado, con su marcado crecimiento, y ese mercado, el marcado crecimiento de la demanda de la deuda externa de nuestro país, la cual ascendía el año pasado alrededor de 4.000 millones de dólares, casi 5 veces al nivel que alcanzaba hasta finales de la década del 70. Sin embargo, ese endeudamiento no fue a fortalecer los sectores productivos de nuestro país, ni a favorecer las necesidades de la población. Ese endeudamiento, señores, por un acuerdo con los grupos dominantes y los acreedores del sistema financiero internacional, fue a financiar en el mejor de los casos los altos componentes importados de las también ya importadas tecnologías, de los también ya importados proyectos que llegan a nuestros países. ¿Y eso realmente a quién favoreció? Pues al capital financiero de las economías desarrolladas, vía pago de intereses, asesorías, compras de capital, etc. Otras veces para pagar el mismo servicio de la deuda que hoy en día en nuestro país asciende alrededor de 2.000 millones de dólares. Hoy, el Fondo Monetario Internacional, a través de sus llamadas políticas de ajuste, pretende crear una contracción de nuestra ya estrangular economía. Las propuestas de devaluación de nuestra moneda y la creación de un mercado libre de divisas constituyen mecanismos para reducir el ingreso real, para menoscabar la capacidad de compra del peso dominicano y reducir la demanda interna y, por ende, la calidad de vida del dominicano. Ciertamente, estas propuestas del Fondo Monetario Internacional favorecerían la disminución de lo que hoy es el déficit de nuestra balanza comercial, pero realmente a un costo excesivamente muy alto para nosotros, porque es en base a llevar situaciones de hambre a grandes grupos de la población que hoy perciben salario mínimo o viven apenas del subempleo. Pero los propósitos del Fondo Monetario no quedan ahí, sino van más lejos. Llevan sus propósitos neomalthusianos al largo plazo, porque contraer con esas medidas de ajuste la incipiente actividad productiva de nuestra economía traerá como consecuencia un mayor grado de dependencia y una mayor marginalidad del hombre, acarreando con todos los vicios que implica esa marginalidad. Mantener el orden económico vigente y la consecuente crisis interna que implica el presente modelo de desarrollo nos pondría frente a serias dificultades para resolver los requerimientos de un futuro más largo. De ser así, la República Dominicana, para el año 2000, se encontrará con una dramática situación frente a algunos elementos. En primer lugar, una población de alrededor de 8.6 millones de habitantes, o sea, casi 3 millones por encima de lo que tenemos hoy en día, con un crecimiento desproporcionado de la población urbana, y muy específicamente en la ciudad de Santo Domingo, y una reducción acelerada de lo que es nuestra población agrícola, que es la sustentadora realmente de la actividad productiva y el sector que suministra el 90% de los alimentos de la población, así como que es el sector que sostiene también la actividad agroexportadora nuestra. Por otra parte, tendremos también para el año 2000 alrededor de 1 millón de desempleados. Nos encontraremos frente a un déficit de alimentos de alrededor de un 20% frente a los requerimientos nutricionales de nuestra población, y más aún, nos encontraremos con alrededor de 2 millones de personas viviendo por debajo de la denominada línea de pobreza. Finalmente, sabemos que es nuestra responsabilidad como nación definir una estrategia para superar la crisis actual y garantizar que mejoren las perspectivas para el presente siglo. Pero estamos seguros que para hacer viable cualquier acción nacional se impone la necesidad de un nuevo orden económico internacional. Un nuevo orden internacional donde se redefina la participación de países como el nuestro en el comercio mundial. Un nuevo orden internacional donde se revaloricen nuestras exportaciones y dejemos de ser simples proveedores de materia prima barata. Un nuevo orden internacional donde dejemos de ser fuente de transferencia de recursos de nuestras riquezas, como lo ha sido desde la época de la colonia, a los países industrializados. un nuevo orden económico internacional donde se fortalezcan las iniciativas de integración subregionales y regionales con miras a extender nuestra capacidad de nuestros mercados. Un nuevo orden económico internacional donde el crédito, donde este crédito internacional vaya a las regiones y sectores productivos y prioritarios y no constituya un elemento y un instrumento de expoliación de nuestros recursos y de empobrecimiento para nuestras economías. Gracias.
Man, and I give you now this. Amelia Robinson. Seven.
As
because we are our brother's keepers. When we were struggling in Alabama and Selma, we found that we were not the only ones who were being mistreated, being used and abused, accused of things that we had not done, and excused from our jobs and from trying to be what this country stood for. In spite of that, many of us, like when the sailor goes out to catch fish, and some of them get out of the net, some of us decided that we are a part of this world and a part of our country, that we will contribute everything we can to make the world what it should be. Consequently, we have people who have made great contributions, but they have not been given credit for how many of the people of the world and how many of the black people realize that a black man was the one who made the blueprint in order that all of the bugs could be taken out of the lights and the telephone. And how many of them know that a black man is one who manufactured, who was able to discover the type of machinery that brought forth the type of shoes that we are wearing now? They don't tell us that. They don't tell us that William Hale was the one who was the first to operate open surgery and save man's life. They don't tell black people that the traffic light that have saved many of lives was invented by a black man. No, they don't tell us that. And they don't tell us that because of the fact they don't want me to feel as though I am somebody. But you give people a chance. You let them know that they are somebody. You let them know that they have potentials, and help them to create those potentials to the best of their ability. And there will not be so much money that is spent for jail and for prisons. And I understand it's around $100,000 for 4 years, and an average of $28,000 that is being appropriated for education. We could close these jails and these prisons and use the money to help to make people make contributions to this country.
She has
been able to start from the beginning having growing pains, and she has had labor pains. And when she became fully grown, I think she realized that now I have made it, and began to slip back. However, when we think of our Constitution, with the exception of the Bible, the wise men of this country got together and wrote one of the greatest pieces of literature that ever had been written, our Constitution. This is the guideline for America and for other countries. Having faith in God, they perpetuated this by putting on our paper money and our coins, in God we trust and liberty. This is our Constitution. It guarantees the inalienable rights of man politically, equally, and all men are free and created equal. What happened to the sacred vows that these great men wrote? Are we abiding by our Constitution? Do we give every American a chance to make her contribution without being biased? Have we been fair to our farmers, our black, red, brown, and yellow brothers? Have we been fair to our white brothers? Who holds in their hands the key to unlock the door of human justice, nonviolence, equality, and love for all men? Who holds that key? Only those who have a pure heart and who believe that all people are created equal. Have we become a part of the problem or a part of the solution? We have a lot to accomplish, but it can only be accomplished by cooperation. We must fight against evil forever. We must see that the evil forces do not take over. We realize that we are in a crisis again, and that there are such things that we must combat, such as AIDS, genocide, and a number of other things. But we must make a sound recovery in order that we can again take our place in this world. We must implement technological, agro-industrial. We must make contributions to monetary adjustments, because these are some of the things that this country will have to adjust. Is it fair for third world starving countries to have to send their produce to our country in order that they may pay their debts? The greatest labor of love could be shown if we show our interest in humanity for all people, and that we send technical and scientific assistance into Africa, for example, in order that we might be able to bring running water lines across the continent and help Africa to again grow its fruit and its vegetables and make contributions to the world. This can be done. Remember, we can give a hungry man a fish and he will be able to eat well for a day. But if we teach him how to fish, he will be able to eat the rest of his life, and water across Africa will do just that. America cannot continue to burden these small countries the world over. It is better to sit at the bargaining table, work out a plan to reschedule payments of our debtors, and work together in peace and harmony. I firmly believe that this method is better than the big stick method, which is to divide and have to stop using and abusing people. We cannot take the culture away from people, but what we want to do is to be able to develop the very best in every man. This can be done by sacrificial development of underworld and Americans right here in this country. We want to improve the standard of living for all people, wherever they are. The crisis we are going through strikes at the very heart of American citizens. The rich are frustrated because of the stock market crash. The farmers are committing suicide, and the poor are being reduced to crime and drugs. The INF has become a conversational piece. I challenge America to begin now to fight for the very uplifting of this country and other countries, and to be able to put everybody on a standard of I am somebody. There are greater things to be done than to bicker about little things. We have to use wisdom and use our own minds rather than that of the news media. I think we realize that the news media has been one that has actually destroyed dignity and self-respect in many people. The news media has not only done that, but it has used the news casting of every line, everywhere, in order that they may bring forth and tell you the things that they think perhaps that you would like to know, and not what is true. The news media has not been fair to the people of the world, and neither the people of America. The news media has really taken away from our country, from our people, the right to think for themselves, the right to believe what is really going on and what is true. Because most people believe just what they read. And if you say to them, and I'm quite sure you have found this out, if you say to them, do you know such and such a thing has happened, they will tell you, oh no, the news media has said thus and so. I have asked a lot of people from time to time to say, to tell me what they think of Scheller Institute, of the LaRouche, and what have they told me. The news media says this and that. I said, isn't it time for you to believe yourselves? This is one of the things that Martin tried to get Americans to do, to believe in yourself and believe that you have the same type of mind to think. And if you read something, think through it, see whether it even sounds reasonable and sensible. But as a rule, we just believe what we read and we stop with that. We have a man whom I feel that is the man of God. And just as Martin Luther King came to this country, this world, to save this country, I believe that this is another leader who has been designated by God because of the fact that he is humble, he's understanding. He's wise. And if we do not do something to save this country and the world, I fear we will all go down the drain. Whom shall we elect for our president and our leader? It's up to you. And like Martin Luther King, I think he is a God-sent man. I think Lyndon has not decided within himself that he wants to be president. I think he has an inward force that is saying that things have gone too far. This world is about to topple over. and I have been given by the Supreme Being the tools, the mental tools, to help to straighten this country out.
Through Sheila Jones, a message to this conference.
And I thought you should, you'd like to hear how people outside think about proceedings here. He says, dear friends of humanity, the absolutely crucial need for economic justice has never been so clear as it is today. For the past few weeks, there have been a series of articles in the Illinois press of how rapidly the American population is facing the very real possibility of extinction. As an example, he quotes, a nine-year-old girl was discovered in an abandoned building behind a padlocked door during one of the most bitterly cold days of the winter season thus far. City workers were about to board the building up when they heard a child's voice crying, let me out, please, let me out. But opening the padlocked door, they found this little girl who had been severely frostbitten with gangrene already savaging both of her legs. Doctors eventually had to amputate both of her legs, and her mother was found, and she's now in jail facing charges for neglect. But I must tell you that the child's one request after her legs were removed was, where is my mother? I want my mother. This goes on to say, another indication of the brutality of the times, a father was in the delivery room and upon seeing that his newborn baby had been born with a cleft lip and an imperfect heart. Chicago, this is. He dashed the baby's head to the floor twice and killed it because he said such a baby was not accepted. The Illinois court, you will be pleased to hear, or displeased to hear, to the surprise of no student of modern American jurisprudence, Illinois court found the father not guilty of murder. But the historic conference, Mr. Love says, at the Schiller Institute is very important because America must not be made vulnerable. Our people in America must have hope and the determination to live full lives. The work ethic is so ingrained in our hearts and in the Constitution that we must not, never allow it to be crushed. Our domestic policies must become our priority. It must not be the narcotics trade. Our nation must change its orientation towards looking and protecting the narcotics trade because of economic dependency and a cash flow. The mother who locked her child in the abandoned building was involved in the narcotics trade. She was a consumer. She was part of the narcotics culture. This must change. There are over 40,000 homeless people in the city of Chicago. Many of these homeless have been in the streets for over 20 years. However, there's a new layer of downtrodden homeless living from garbage cans from day to day, who are 25 to 30 years of age, recently driven to the streets, some of them, as a result of the last wave of shutdown of industries and businesses in the Chicago area. Approximately 10,000 of the homeless in Chicago, he says, are families, mothers, their children. They're living in the O'Hare Airport. They live in the Union Station, which is, you mean, the train station. In the housing projects of Chicago, she says, during the most bitter days and nights of below zero temperatures, ice-covered water pipes, ceilings and windows, no heating, these people fight for existence. There should be no homeless Americans. There must be hope, and there must be help for people who have become hurt and pained by the injustice and selfishness of the powers that be. The system must function not for itself, but for people. We must not keep grinding up humanity in the name of system. How can we get the skilled part of making history for the dead. We must get back to the real basis that is America. People are the foot. America used to be called the last frontier. It used to be said, go west, young man. Well, we are the west. When I heard of the great success of the first days of this glorious conference, my heart was moved. I agree that many potentials afford this world the supreme chance to end the economic holocaust that's befalling civilization. For this, the Schiller Institute and all of us must establish the global means to build a new future, a better world. Through this, we will liberate those who wish to act, have not yet grasped the vision, nor found the courage to realize that now is the time for action. Now is the time to win. What you do there shall determine the fate of all of humanity. This we shall ring out loudly throughout the entire world. My heart, my mind go with all of you, sincerely.
Busloads of people in Washington, D.C. then the enemy said this, Mr. LaRouche, that it was 20,000, and if you'd have seen the crowd, it was a whole lot closer to 40,000 than it was 20,000. But they minimized us just whenever they can. We had people from Washington, D.C. was there. Then people from neighbors coming cars around. We had a crowd. Yesterday, one of my good friends from Oklahoma, he made a talk here and made a beautiful talk. I enjoyed it. And he said he was a Republican, and I'm here today, and I'm a Democrat. Now that makes a pretty good cross section. And then to tell you the whole truth, I might have been Republican myself if it hadn't been for a fellow way back down to some of you all might have heard about that called Herbert Hoover. And I grew up on the farm and we was poor, and we were so poor until the poor people called us poor. I remember we had cornbread and molasses for breakfast. We had molasses and cornbread for dinner and had both of them so. And you could go to school, we was all school age at that time back there, go to school, and if your mouth wasn't greasy, the little kids picked at you because they know you didn't have no meat for breakfast. And mama had an old skin, and when we'd get ready to go to school, it would sink, so she'd just call us and wipe our mouths with that old skin so the little kids wouldn't pick at us and think that we had some meat for breakfast. I remember I left home long about that time, trying to make it better. Caught a freight train, I went to California. I didn't have but $1.35 when I left, and when I got to California, I was broke, and I met a white fella, and I asked him for money enough to get something to eat, and he said, son, he said, I'm almost in your shape. He said, I ain't got no money. He said, but they got a soup line down on 16th Street, and he said, you can get some soup. And I went out there and I got in that soup line about 9 o'clock and I stayed in it till 15 minutes till 5. Three people before they got to me, they run out of soup. I sat down and wrote my dad a letter, told him the condition I was in, my shoes was wore out, my clothes were ragged, hadn't eaten nothing in 2 days, and I signed off. I said, no more, no fun, your son. So in a few days, I get some letter back from the old man, and he writes me a pitiful letter, and he said the old milk cow had died, and one of the mules was crippled, and it just wasn't nothing he could do, and he signed off, too bad, too sad, your day. But he said, son, if you can make it home, said, we'll kill the batman home. And I caught a freight train, and in a few days I was home, and we went out there to kill the vet and home. He was so narrow between the eyes we couldn't shoot him. We had to smother him to death. You know, and I've heard him talking about the bankers. Now, that's something else I know something about. We had a little old farm. We had 25 acres. We rented 100 acres. And my dad, he'd go and borrow it. Back then, you could borrow about $150 to make a crop that year. And well, Watts, now you got them two teams? Yeah. He's putting all that down. You got harness with them mules? Yeah. How many head of cows you got, Watts? Well, I've got 26. How many hogs you got? And I seen them back in the 30s clean my dad completely out. Drove 26 head of cows out of the lot, took two teams of mules, took the harness, got all the chicken and hogs, and mama standing there with tears in her eyes. I know what the bankers will do to you. Know them boys real well. My brother, he bought a farm and he lost it. 2 or 3 years later, he got money enough to buy another farm. And a fellow come to him and told him, he said, I'll tell you what I'm doing. He said, I'll give you a deed to it. He said, I don't want no deed. He said, said, I had one with a deed to it, and he said, the mortgage took it. He said, I want one with a mortgage to it. He said, the mortgage is more powerful than the deed. I've got a friend that I came here with, and I want him to stand up. George Gentry, stand up and let the people see. Now I want you to watch this.